Hello? Hello, good afternoon. Did everyone hear me? We're about ready to get started here. For those of us joining us via the internet, we don't really have a volume control. Is that any better? Okay. I'll try to be really close to the mic for now. For those of us joining us via the internet, if you could chat in your comments, questions, concerns, we will address them as they're brought to us. We have a question? Hello? All right. I don't really have control over the speakers in this room right now, so I'm trying my best to talk as loud as I can. I don't tend to be the loudest person, so bear with me. All right. All right, well, welcome everyone to the NWI's 2014 Open Meeting and 10th Anniversary Celebration. Happy birthday and congratulations. Fantastic. The National Wraparound Initiative, I just got really loud. we're located out of Portland State University. We work with the University of Washington, and we're a core partner with the Technical Assistance Network for Children's Behavioral Health and all the other wonderful partners that you see below. All right, so for today's meeting, we're going to try to pack in a whole lot and also give you a chance to participate and have some input. Again, we thank all of you for traveling and those of us that are joining us via the web. First of all, I'd like to give some updates about the National Wraparound Initiative, what's working and what are our challenges. Then we're going to talk about some new projects we're really excited about and have a small group discussion around those projects and future directions. Gary Blau will be coming to visit. And then we're very pleased with our colleagues at University of Maryland to introduce NWIC, the National Wraparound Implementation Center, which we're all receiving very warmly. And then we'll have an update from WERT, the Wraparound Evaluation Research Team, which I love the acronym. I think it's great. All right. Oh, and Janet.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. It's great to see folks here spanning all the years that I've been involved with the National Wraparound Initiative from the very beginning to the very new. Just, it's great to have a chance to get together with everybody and to meet some new folks. I did want to let you know, if you haven't noticed already, Eric is not here. And he actually has a family commitment where his wife has a very important kind of career-making event going on, and he's along for childcare. So we all know that you have to be flexible in order to make your life work out. Yes, indeed. So, we're going to try to give you a good update of kind of where we are, where we see the NWI going. For me personally, it's a little hard to believe that it's only been 10 years. I actually feel like we've been going for longer than that. I think actually our first meeting was 2003. But when we didn't really start the NWI till kind of a little bit later. So it's interesting for me in particular just to think back across the 10 years and what we've done and also the many things we tried to do that didn't quite work out. And we'll be hearing some about both of those today. So I'm going to turn it over to John to give you some updates. I should actually probably introduce him. He was going to introduce himself. But this is John Osowski. He's our new staff at the NWI. He's like our main glue now, and he's probably your main point of contact. So he'll be talking a little bit about the things that come under his job, including a lot of our outreach. And then we're going to go on to talk about some other projects and other things that we have going on at the NWI. So welcome, everybody. It's great to see you. And hopefully we will make good use of our time together today. Thanks. Oops, I think I leaned on the slide changer. Okay.
And again, I just wanted to acknowledge, I walked in here about 6 months ago. And so I really feel privileged that I walk in after, 10 years of the hardest work is putting something like this together. So again, thank you to all of you. But let's not look back 10 years, let's look ahead 10 years, and let's see what's in store for us. Let's see. Oh yeah, there was my introduction slide. So who is this person? I am me. I also have phonetic spelling of my last name. It tends to trip people up, but it's kind of like it's spelled, Osowski. I am a graduate of Portland State, and I was very honored that they'd have me back as an employee. I got my MSW there, and I specialized in community-based practice. Most of my experience, and I was very pleased to be brought on to the National Wraparound Initiative has been in education and social work. And a lot of the initiatives that I was part of used a wraparound-y process, but in schools, in school systems with kids. And I can attest to that process of everyone coming together, getting out of their silos, focusing on strengths, being driven by a different set of principles definitely works, and I believe it works in this field as well. Feel free to email me if anybody wants any more information, or if you just want to talk. I think my number is on the website too, so feel free to call. All right. So sustainability, this is the first topic. What does it mean and why does it exist for another 10 years? And really, it's an engaged membership like yourselves who are part of an active community of practice. We'll talk a little bit about what that means or what it could mean. And it's supported by organizations and individuals. I'm going to cover those three major points. So in a nutshell, what's working, I want to talk about our internet presence. I want to talk about the wraparound track we had in Tampa, some of our research and resources that are freely available. Janet will give some updates on our NREP application for wraparound and a new research consensus building project that we're working on. So internet presence. If you look at our traffic to the website, nwi.pdx.edu, traffic is up 37% in 2014 so far. So that's quite remarkable. And that means that people are actually accessing the resources and using them. We have 35% more users, which is also really impressive, because that means it's not just the folks that are, you know, frequenting it for their own information, but there are new folks coming on board. Now, granted, analytics and statistics can be kind of skewed one way or the other, and not every, you know, you may be logging in from a new computer but using this website for 10 years, but I'm sure that if there's a 35% increase, not all 35% are new computers. I'm sure we've got a lot of new people looking at what we have. You're not seeing double. This is actually the percentage of new users. Even though we have this increased volume, we're still attracting about the same percent of new users, which I think is interesting. Still very robust, let's just put it that way. We've got a lot more newsletters going out. I attribute this in part to some of the traffic that's been going on our website. We've had 9 newsletters in 2014 so far. They go out to a list of about 20,000 people altogether. You can always access the newsletters. They're archived right on the website under News and Events. Click on Archive Newsletters, so in case you misplaced the email or something happened, you can always get it back. So we're doing really well with that and trying to get more contact actually put out there to folks in the field. And through all of this, if you have any questions or comment or something you want to share, please feel free to raise your hand. I'd be glad to try to address it as best I can. Our Facebook group, and for those of you that were in the picture, you are now on Facebook. I love this era of like instant social messaging. We're over 200 likes, which is pretty good. We started out the year with about 57, so we're growing. I'm trying to find content that people seem to be responding more to on Facebook, and that really happens to be first-person stories, in particular videos. So if anyone comes across anything on YouTube or a new video that's put out, especially videos that are made by youth for youth or that talk about mental health conditions that youth face and how they work with each other to face them, I'd be glad to post that there. I think people are looking for that. Let's see. Webinars. I won't read the entire list to you, but we've had 8 since the last open meeting. Our whole range of topics. These webinars are also available online. They're archived just like the newsletters are, and you can access them and listen to them here. This broadcast as well will be archived in the webinar space so that you can actually get back to it and listen. 27th Annual Children's Mental Health Research and Policy Conference featured a wraparound track. There were 12 papers, 3 discussions, 2 symposia. Question?
Quite after the board invited, in relationship to wraparound or in relationship to
generic
use and mental health kinds of
things? Oh, for Facebook, you mean? Yeah, anything that's pertinent like that. Most of the stuff that I'm finding is more general about youth that are facing, that have mental health needs and how they're facing them. But if there's anything that's wraparound specific too, that would be great.
So let me answer. So are you looking for a general or wraparound specific? Okay.
Both.
Great.
Yep. And for the study, we'll be looking for wraparound.
Yes, we'll get to that later.
Yeah. Did you want to add something?
No, I just go with reference to the webinars. I actually just wanted to let you guys know. So our webinars get, I would say between an average of about 250 and 600 people actually attending. So that's registrants up towards 1,000 sometimes, because not everybody shows up, obviously. But that's actually really good attendance. So another thing, we're going to be asking you later on today in your small groups, part of it as just a quick brainstorming of some kind of quick things that NWI could do. So topics for webinars, for example, that you might like to see or that you feel like you would be good at presenting would be some one of those things. We're trying to get our ideas together for putting together our program for next year. How many people have been on, have listened to at least one webinar in the last? Okay, great. Great. And you can see that. I think it's a great outreach strategy for the NWI and something that people will obviously find helpful. So thanks. Yeah, that's interesting.
And thanks for your question. I'm sorry. I think I was just like, you're with headlights up here. I thought you were asking about Facebook. And so I'm glad that got cleared up. All right. Let's see. We have a whole bunch of new research and resources since our last open meeting, including 8 peer-reviewed articles. And again, those are available through the website as well and under the wraparound research section.
I think another thing that's particularly valuable on the website, and I'm not sure if people are always necessarily aware of the new additions that we've been making as far as resources for wraparound. So we've been adding pretty regularly a variety of other resources. If you read the newsletter regularly or look at the boxes on the homepage, that's one way to keep track of it. But I'd say in the last year, we've added year to year and a half, maybe 5 new cost studies, including both kind of rigorous research and more evaluation type stuff, high quality evaluation, all of which are looking at either just with cost savings from wraparound and or with cost effectiveness, so good or better outcomes at same or reduced cost. So those are some pretty interesting new studies. And there's also a webinar that we did. One of them was on cost effectiveness. So if you want to sort of see the bigger context for that, one of the webinars from the spring, and Bruce Cameron was one of our key speakers on that, talking about wraparound Milwaukee's cost studies. We also have a peer support literature review. We did a series of things. This was actually through Pathways, but it was posted on the NWI on youth and young adult peer support in wraparound. And there's a really excellent resource that has come out from CHCS, state scan of wraparound programs. It's all sorts of interesting information, all the way from information about, so in each state there's a little table that covers the same information, things like case rate, what are the funding sources, what are the caseload ratios, et cetera. So a very useful document, and we plan to be producing kind of mini reports out of that that focus on sort of one topic to compare across states. So that has just been released, and I don't think we've actually announced it yet, but they're going to be announcing it here and actually going to have some print copies available. So that is a really useful new product. The other thing that we've done over the last couple years, and I would say there's a number of people in this room who have been involved in the sort of collaborative work that the NWI has kind of tried to have as kind of a key theme in the work that we've been doing, where we work with kind of a shifting, shifting constellation of work groups, I guess, to produce some of these products. And the most recent one, which is actually finished almost a year ago, was the Guidelines on Training, Coaching, and Supervision. Have people seen that one? Raise your hand, maybe. Okay, so not so much. But this was something that we did kind of in response to an experienced need from the field to kind of advocate for the importance of ongoing coaching. That sort of initial training is not sufficient. And so these guidelines describe the kind of ongoing training and coaching that we think is sort of a minimal amount of what's necessary in order to achieve and sustain high quality practice. So it's a relatively brief document, so I encourage you to take a look at it if you haven't seen it so far, because we're thinking it's the kind of thing that you can use in your advocacy efforts to argue for the need for this kind of thing to be supported and funded. Another short document that we did was qualifications for family partners in Wraparound. Again, there was this sort of communicated to us from you all, basically, that people were sometimes getting hired as peer support partners who didn't really have that peer experience. So we wanted to have a definition that the National Wraparound Initiative endorsed about what kind of experience it would take to be a peer support partner. Again, that's probably a 2 or 3 page document, pretty straightforward. Then we did a lot of work, this was a little bit further in the past, on the theory of change. And that was tremendously complicated work. We haven't, I guess, finalized anything out of that yet, but I'm going to talk a little bit about our efforts to build off of that in a new project that we're starting. We'll talk about that in a little bit. So one of the things, again, that we're going to ask you to discuss in the group, so these are things we're kind of already doing or with the webinars that we can easily add on to the sort of kind of ongoing strands of work that we have. How can we get the word out about these things more effectively, or do we need to, I guess, and if so? So we're going to have a little bit of a discussion, kind of like, I guess I think of it as sort of the low-hanging fruit discussion. So what are the things that the NWI could easily build on that don't take a whole bunch more resources, but just how can we strategically make sure that we're having the kind of impact and reach that we want to have? So that's kind of that. And then I did want to just give you a little update on NRAP. How many people know about NRAP? Raise your hands. Okay. Well, I'm glad Gary wasn't here to see that. So NRAP is a National Registry of Effective Programs and Practices. It's SAMHSA, under SAMHSA's purview, I suppose. And it's a place where people can go, and actually you might want to check it out. You can go and kind of look up programs, and basically it's in sort of general mental health, behavioral health area, and see what's listed under different kind of categories. So you can search by keyword, you can sort it by population, by venue, etc. Among the different types of information that you find there is information about the research base that supports it, and it's kind of graded as far as the quality goes, as well as the dissemination capacity of the people who are sort of sponsoring the listing. And so the NRAP has become pretty large, and they only have open submission during certain limited periods of time. So during the last one, which was this year in January, part of January and February, we put Wraparound in and proposed it for listing. And as you can see here, that you have to kind of pass an initial scrutiny, I guess, where you kind of upload some basic information about what's the research base, and also can you show that if people want to use Wraparound that they could get implementation support, essentially. And so we passed that area. I actually think we have a very reasonable chance of getting listed because the research base is not perfect, but there is decent research for Wraparound, and again, this is something that we have sort of tried to keep up to date on the website. So we're kind of awaiting the next round of review where I think they ask you to submit more stuff and to kind of provide more detail. And I have no idea, and in fact, I don't think they do, of what the timeline is for that. So I think they have a certain number of programs that pass that initial review, and then you kind of wait and see when they get down to you on their list of programs. And so we'll see. I'm reasonably actually optimistic about that. So that could be helpful for people who, again, are advocating for Wraparound implementation. Any questions about any of that stuff? Comments? All right, moving right ahead. What do we have next? Okay.
Okay, thanks, Janet. Now we get to talk about what's challenging. And an overview of that would be, I want to talk a little bit about what the membership looks like statistically and demographically in terms of trends, our financial picture, and then the challenge of engaging members and stakeholders in a way that's meaningful for everybody and good for the field. So as of, oh gosh, a couple days ago, we had 46 individual memberships broken down into these different categories, and these are current paid memberships. We also have bundles of members who belong to organizations. We have 54 of those organizations with 343 individuals in them. And you can see they're broken down by small, medium, and large groups. We have a Get Notified list, which is basically folks that come to the website. They don't really want to contribute for the individual level, but they still want to be informed, and they are about 850. And then the total mailing list includes that list and then all the members and then some, and we're about 20,000 there. So our reach is pretty wide, but the trends, they're interesting. So in the individual level, we've lost quite a few current paid individual memberships over the past 2 years. This is 2012 in yellow versus 2014 in blue. Organizationally, it doesn't seem like we've lost all that many except in the medium category, but when I show you the financial picture, those matter a lot. And you'll see that our annual income, 2012 to 2014, has been going down steadily. And a lot of that is because most of our revenue does come from those organizational memberships. Even though there are fewer of them than individuals, they count for a lot more of our income. And Janet wants to add something?
Yeah. So this is interesting. I mean, any of you who have been around a long time will probably maybe remember how all of this got started. We embarked on the membership originally thinking that, it would be a major source of our funding. I think the clear message that we've gotten over the last few years is that it's probably never going to be. With John hired in this new position, at least there's someone who can follow up. You know, it's difficult to track the organizations over time. A lot of them are kind of grants. They buy a membership, and then the grant's gone, and you can't even find whom to call at that place anymore. It might have been an administrative person or whatever. So John's been putting, I would say, his best effort it took him a few months to get started, but, you know, we kind of gave him a year to see what kind of payback we could get from the membership effort. So another question that's sort of open in our minds is whether that is even actually worth the time that we put into it to have John kind of work with people to track the memberships and all of that. So that, in my mind, is a very open question. We've been fortunate in that it's not our only source of revenue, so we're going to talk a little bit about that. So the other kind of challenge that's been, I would say, an ongoing thing with the NWI has been the sort of community of practice, that interactive sort of engagement piece that we periodically, whenever we come together, people are interested in, but we really have a hard time kind of actually making it stick. And we had originally invested a lot of work in our website that we have, but really didn't find that people were using the forums or the blogs. We use it ourselves to post our own news so that people can easily access that. And we'll talk a little bit more about the reasons for that. The work groups, again, have been really hard to work with. It's everybody's busy. The idea of getting people to volunteer a regular amount of time to do that amount of work and to come consistently to show up for different projects, like, has been really challenging because there might be, say, a core of people who are there most of the time and other people kind of drift in and out, and it's very difficult to kind of get a focus and to move forward with a project when there's always shifting people who have very strong and well-reasoned input. But it gets hard to move ahead. And then I think the other piece is that a lot of times people look to the NWI for a lot more than we have the capacity to deliver. I mean, we have a total FTE of probably 0.7, like, so not even one full-time person worth on the NWI. And so that's mostly John and a little bit of me and a little bit of a person who does, like, our web and products. So I think if you look at it that way, I think we're remarkably productive. But people come to us and say, you know, why isn't there research on some huge big topic, like maybe family support in Wraparound? Why can't you prove that it works, which is a very complex topic, actually? Or can you come and train our county, which we can't do. We don't have trainers. We don't have any of that. So we keep plugging away at these challenges, because these are essentially the challenges we had since the very beginning. So we're going to talk about, again, we're going to ask you for some of your ideas. But as we mentioned before, are joining the Technical Assistance Network as the NWI. That's basically funding our core, some of our core activities, including the webinars and the newsletter. So that's a piece of fairly sustainable funding that's going on right now. And the TAN is what is the technical assistance to the system of care sites. So that contract is sort of acknowledged that the NWI plays a supportive role for a lot of communities. And so that and we're going to talk about NWIC in just a little bit. So I don't really want to launch into that quite ready, but just to let you know that that's also part of our kind of ongoing sustainability strategy. As far as engaging our members, part of what we thought was the problem, and we've certainly gotten a lot of feedback on this, is that the website is kind of clunky the way it is. How many of you guys have ever tried to, like, access the member website? And do you find it difficult? Yeah. Okay, so we're trying to get away from all of that. Again, and I mean, part of our strategy for this, we you know, when we started out with all this, we thought, well, we got to give some benefits to membership so that people will pay for it. But it's kind of like they're not really paying for it and nobody's using it. So we're really actually making most things just totally accessible. There's not going to be a lot of leftover benefit for membership, but we kind of figure that people who want to support us will be supporting us, and there's not a lot we can do to force people at that level to kind of pay up. So the new website, we're going to have a little preview of that. We think it alleviates a lot of those problems. Certainly it will make it much easier to be part of any kind of forums and stuff. Whether people will post or not is still unclear to me. I think... I don't know, it has yet to be seen. But again, when you're in your small groups thinking about, okay, we're going to have this new website, what we're still actually at the point where we could do quite a bit of tweaking. I mean, we've done a lot of work on it, but if you have ideas for us about how to organize that or what we could do, that would be really helpful. With the work groups, well, we have some new research project where we're going to be talking to you about, and we actually have the resource in the short term to pay people to participate in this. So we're hoping that that will enable us to make some progress on what we think is a pretty interesting new topic. And basically, those requests that we aren't able to handle, part of the answer to that is our collaboration with NWIC. And part of it is also and another, again, issue that I hope that maybe you will be discuss in your small groups. We've always had a listing of consultants on the NWI website. It's been a very, I think, partial listing, given that we know there are plenty of people who are great consultants who aren't even on that list. And there's sort of a do-it-yourself, here's some things to make sure that you don't get rooked when you're hiring a consultant, like advice on there too. But again, I mean, I feel like, because our idea is we have no way of advocating or judging the quality of anybody's consultation work, even though, of course, we have lots of people that we know and respect, but we don't have a reliable or definitive way of kind of weeding out bad ones, promoting good ones, etc. So our ability to support people in that is very limited. So again, if you have ideas on that in your small group of some way that we could make that consultation, that reference process, referral process somehow more viable, that would be great to hear about. So that is kind of my take on some of the challenges and kind of where we think we're going with those in the near future. And so John's going to talk about the website.
Great. Thanks, Jan. And at this point, are there any questions in the room or on the web? I just want to thank Nancy for taking care of the web questions for us. So if you are on the web and you have questions, please chat them in. And this will be recorded and archived on our website as well. So if you miss anything, you'll be able to get it. So the new website, I'm really excited about this because I did raise my hand when I thought the website was clunky, and I did raise my hand and say it wasn't easy to access. And that's, there are technical, I won't go into it. There are technical things about why that is. This new website, however, should work seamlessly, and it's designed to promote a lot more interaction, and you can see the bold new, even the aesthetics of it, have changed to reflect the new internet and the, you know, the need we have for more member-driven content and engagement. So basically, it's been designed to be easier to navigate, and we are going to have blogs and forums and discussions and a member directory while maintaining all of the relevant content that will hopefully be easier to find. And again, there's another comp page of what one of our news feeds, our discussion feeds might look like. Not really, you know, part of me wonders too, in regards to the website, maybe you all can answer this better than I can, but I'm not sure how comfortable everyone is interacting with social media or with discussion forums and blogs and things. Or are you more let's get together at a conference and talk kind of folks? So that's something to think about. But when you're spread across an entire country as big as ours, and some members are actually on a different continent, the internet does play a role in trying to help bring people together. I do want to talk about how the new website is going to change the member benefits. Okay, we are definitely moving more from what I would call a transactional model of giving, where you give, you get something, to a philanthropic model of giving, where what you give is given from your heart. But what you get is also something important. I don't think the member benefits are totally wiped away. So while we've made all of the things on the one side open to everyone, including the newsletters and all those archives, the resource library, webinars, blogs, forums, discussions, with moderation if you're not a member, viewing the membership directory, so that'll be like a, you know, the go-to 411 yellow pages of Wraparound from the National Wraparound Initiative, and to view the member spotlight. We're trying to create a place, as we have in the past newsletters, to highlight the work of the members. What are you doing, and where are you located, and how can folks get in touch with you and, you know, learn more about the exemplary work that you're doing? But membership will get you a listing in the membership directory so people can actually find you. If you're not a member, you're not going to be there. You have a chance to be a spotlighted member, obviously, because if you're not a member, you can't be a spotlighted member. Blogs, forums, discussions, you can participate in them without moderation. So all you would do is log into the website and you have free rein to post your thoughts. You can list an event, being a member. We have priority seating for webinars, and this is a little bit of a fuzzy benefit, but it is a benefit. Webinars have a certain amount of seats available to them. As much as we've been frequently, had over, several hundred people attending, at some point there is a limit, and if we ever did reach that limit, then it would be member first priority. And you would be able to use the NWI membership seal on your website. Maybe we can make a window cling. You can put it in your car or something, like NPR would do, just to show that you support this and that you're part of it. And we all have a little bit of a chuckle about it. It's true. It's not like the greatest thing, but it shows that you're part of something, and it lets people know that this resource is there. And better, from my point of view, is that if they know the resource is there, they're going to be able to access all the things that we've opened up that members have made possible. So that's the new website in a nutshell. And now I'll have Janet talk about our new project.
Yeah, so I've been alluding to this throughout my comments. It's actually something I'm very excited about. And it's made possible, this new project that we're talking about, because of an innovation, I suppose, that we've developed at Portland State University that we call the video or the virtual coaching platform, so VCP. And if you want to hear more about that, we're doing a whole institute on the use of technology in Wraparound. I forget if somebody knows our number and when it is.
Four.
Number four. And it's, when is it?
It's on Thursday
Thursday afternoon? Okay. All right. Thursday and Saturday. Yeah, so if you want more details about that, but essentially it's what we have put together at Portland State, and it wasn't developed exclusively or even originally for Wraparound, but for some of our other projects that we actually implement as part of our research studies. And it's a mechanism for what we call remote coaching. So you can use videotape material to coach people who are not actually in the same place as you are. We actually use it for our staff in projects at Portland State because we're not on site with them. So it's remote even to that extent, that even though they are working in our office, it allows us to observe and give structured feedback on their work, even when we can't go to observe them, which we think is really important because with our research studies, we're, of course, very concerned with maintaining a high level of fidelity in our in the practice that our folks are doing. But essentially, the part I want to focus on here is what it's enabling us to do, I think, for the first time with Wraparound. So our goal is to use actual videos, footage of Wraparound teams and also Wraparound personnel. So we're going to, I think, start with facilitators, but you could see this easily as translating to the family partner role as well in interaction with the families or the teams, as the case may be. And we are in the process of recruiting some experts who are very familiar with practice, who routinely see multiple teams people in practice, to take a small subset of these videos and do some rating of different features. And that's, remember where I spoke about this, the theory of change. So we're actually going to draw some of those key elements out of the theory of change and ask people to go kind of minute by minute, actually, so maybe 15 minutes looking at the videos, scoring these different elements, commenting about what they're looking at when they're scoring. So the VCP actually has, you can minute by minute go and rate it, and you can comment on any parameter that you're rating or overall. And kind of also same thing, ask them, is there anything sort of missing that you don't think our rating scale is getting at in this particular segment? And then we're going to compare across our folks to see whether they're really looking for the same things and whether they agree about the extent to which these features are present. And so what we're kind of hoping is that people will start out kind of from their, we anticipate, somewhat divergent points of view, and then that will enrich our understanding of what the commonality is and help to clarify. So as a kind of a corollary to that, we are currently recruiting experts to be part of our study. So if you are or think you know someone who has that level of kind of ongoing experience with Wraparound, so you're regularly seeing multiple teams at work, and I think our minimum was 10 that you've seen, we invite you to apply to be in the study. We only have a limited space, but we haven't filled it up yet, and we are paying stipends to the people who are participating in that. It might be, I mean, you can imagine that doing even 15 minutes of a video with that level of commentary that I've spoken about is probably a couple hours of a commitment just for that round, and we anticipate multiple rounds. On the other hand, if you're like me, I see this totally fascinating project, and I'm really eager to see what emerges from this, because I think it allows this kind of level of basic research and insight into that team meeting and how people are evaluating practice that we haven't really been able to have before. Another issue of that is, though, we also need people to help us get those videos. So we're also asking the people to help who are experts to help us to have the goal of facilitating us getting a video to also bring into the study, because we need that raw material as well. And that kind of brings me to part two, which is another thing that we're working at through VCP, is an effort to build a library of videos that we have permission to share for training purposes. So this is beyond the research study. With the research study, it would just be those small group of experts looking at. What we really would like to be able to do then is to use those and other videos that we're trying to accumulate right now to kind of set up a library within VCP. Another thing you can do very easily is to create a library, and you can tag it with all sorts of different tags. And people who so VCP is like its own, it's a website, it's web-based, and it's a secure website. So people who have permission can log on there and see examples of practice. And we think that this will be very valuable for all sorts of training opportunities, because so few people get to really see maybe some practice, but certainly not a lot of practice, and certainly not practice where we can say 10 NWI experts have had a consensus that this is an excellent example of doing something. And I think also sometimes somewhat subtle around strengths or around family needs or whatever the final decisions will be. And the opportunity to compare, well, here's a novice person, so we hope we also get some novice videos. Here's a novice person doing, you know, sort of step X in the Wraparound, and here are two or three examples of really experienced people, and so that people can compare and see not just one role model, but a couple of different role models. One maybe that seems a little bit more like your style or whatever. So we think there's enormous potential here, but this is an area where we totally, really need everybody's help We're actually on kind of a short timeline with this because we have a limited kind of horizon on the funding that we have for this project. Needs to be spent by October 1st. So we are willing, though, we would like to, I mean, anybody who thinks they can get a video for us for this portion of the library, we're paying incentives to the person who gets it, to the facilitator, the family, the youth, and all the team members. So, I mean, we think this is really important. We've passed it by the IRB, so it's not a level where it's at a bribey level, but it's at a level where it respects everybody's time, because it obviously takes some time to do this. So if you think at all that you could do this, John is in charge of this. We really, really need help. You know, it's not that easy to get these videos, but we feel like it's super important. And you guys are kind of like our ambassadors to the field to be able to help us with that. So that is kind of the new project. I'm sorry? Oh, well, it's all over the place, isn't it? I'm just really excited about this work, and I certainly know that some of the people that have been engaged so far also, so I think it would be just really interesting to see what comes out of that. Oh, yes, so as I mentioned, this is a recap of the TAN slide, and this is, again, as mentioned, this Technical Assistance Network is kind of part of the core funding now for the NWI sort of basic functions. And NWIC also, and we're going to be talking about NWIC a bit after the break. And right now, again, I think we actually have a little bit more time than we originally anticipated. What time are we at?
3.
Okay, so Dr. Gary Blau is scheduled to show up at 3:30, is that correct?
Yes.
So we have some time here, and this is where we'd like to do that small group discussion that we talked about. So we kind of have two sets of questions, and I think if you have a totally full table, you might want to split into like 4, but if you have like less than maybe 8 or 7 people, do it how you want. But we want everybody to get a chance to talk. So what we're going to ask you for is, and you can ignore, we were thinking we might not have that much time. We have a little bit more time than that. So the first thing is, I've kind of been trying to prod you on as we go through here, the sort of quick short-term things that the NWI can do to make its work more accessible, more relevant, just additional, whatever, things that we can kind of do that aren't going to take an enormous resource investment. So again, this is the sort of low-hanging fruit. Any improvements or changes to the newsletter, to the website, additions to the resource library, or the things that you wish there were there you could look up that aren't there. How many people have accessed the resource library? Just another show of hands. Okay, that's pretty good. So at least people are aware of that one. Or any way that we can just make people more aware. I know our website has a lot of stuff on it, and sometimes I feel like you just keep adding stuff, but maybe nobody would notice. So that's one thing. Or maybe there are things we should get rid of. Sometimes I think maybe we should pare it down to maybe just the most essential things. And then we're gonna ask you to sort of wrap that up. So we'll give you some time to do the talking, hopefully make sure everybody at your table gets a chance to talk. And when we have maybe 15 minutes or maybe we'll give you about 5 to 8 minutes to talk about that, and then a couple minutes to just kind of get something to report out. And please keep all your ideas on a paper or something. We're going to kind of collect that. So if it's reasonably like self-explanatory when you write it down, that will be most helpful to us. And then we're going to ask you before the report out also to sort of think about the longer term ideas of what we could be aiming for. And I suppose this is somewhere between like the ideal world and what we can accomplish, maybe somewhere halfway, what is the low-hanging fruit, something in between there. So what could we build on, build towards, focus on, and might we accomplish that? So does that make sense to folks? Anybody have questions before we get started on that? Don't forget to pick someone to report out from your group, okay? Yes? All right. Okay? Okay.
So you want to give them about 3 or 3 5 minutes on this, mm-hmm. And then change gears 5 minutes?
Well, I would say 5 minutes to talk, and then a couple minutes to prioritize.
Okay.
And so why don't you can interrupt me.
Okay.
So,
we're at this time.
Well, let's see. So we have to
Thank you. Okay, folks, so we've got about 2 minutes to wrap up and write down your comments. So we're at the 2 minute mark for this conversation.
Thank you.
And I'm sure that's what the new board head right here.
Okay, folks, so we're at that time now where we want to switch gears and think about the longer term situation. So we're going to take 5 minutes now and think about the long term situation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, folks, we're at that point where we want to kind of wrap up the discussion of the long-term goals. So in about 2 minutes, let's just have everything wrapped up and ready to report back. All right, ladies and gentlemen, if we could wrap it up in about one more minute and be ready to report back, that would be great. So about one more minute, please. Okay, folks, so we're ready to report back now. We just wind up what you're talking about. We appreciate your attention and input. And we hope that you've designated a spokesperson who's rather extroverted. I just blank and you can type.
No, okay.
All right. Do you want me to type?
Yeah. Why don't you just get folks started? Are you going to type? You put typer?
Okay. You can do it. You can talk.
Okay, everyone. You know what? We're going to build some more discussion in at the end. So right now, we'd really like to hear what you guys have to say about our questions. And I know that it's very easy to get involved in other discussions, so if you don't have exactly the answers that we asked for, but you have something else that you think we really ought to know, feel free to report that too. So what we wanted to do was start out with the what we were calling the low-hanging fruit. So some things that we're kind of already doing that we could do better, do differently, or some minor additions, etc. So anybody want to report out on that particular aspect of things? Please raise your hand. Okay, back there, I see two people. Somebody get up. Yep, the low-hanging fruit, please, and speak up.
Mm-hmm. And maybe a family page and interest page. We talked about maybe having a youth membership.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, with a lower amount. And then we thought about some other things too, like maybe an app.
Okay, and what sort of an app would we what would it do? Mm-hmm.
Also, you know, some simple resources and things. We also said maybe a video blog that you're already doing the blogs, but like a video blog for families to come on and they can take like their own videos about how they like wrapping or what they find interesting. And then we said we want to ensure that the information not only goes out to the organizations themselves, but how do we reach the ground level people, the people, the everyday people that are working, and give them the ability to get the information that's out there.
Mm-hmm.
Because we feel like if that happens, they will become members, and even giving them free membership, just so that people, I think you have that already.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. Okay, so I think we got most of that down. That looks good. Anybody else want to add to that or give their list? I see someone else back here. Yeah. So sort of like a quick resource search type thing?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
My family's moving to Arizona. they want to get this kind of help, how do you connect them? I mean, who there's on the call?
Mm-hmm. Well, we actually have that. I'm not sure. Actually, I can't remember. Do you know if we're planning to carry over that? It's kind of under the Wrap USA. The part of the problem was that people weren't updating their information ever, and we never felt like we got a very complete listing. I'm thinking with our new approach, it's all WordPress. There are modules that you can put in that are pretty easy. If people really wanted to do that, it wouldn't be so hard. And I agree, it was in the clunky side of the website, and it was in its own like little world. So maybe that's something we could try again. But that does rest on people being responsive and updating, and I just don't know how feasible that actually is, because you do have to give people a password. That stuff has to be password protected so that people can't just get in there and mess up your thing. So I don't know. I mean, it'd be interesting to see what people think about whether that would do. But it's all that communication with people. Who's the spokesperson? Are they still there? You send an email for the updating. So all of that is just a little bit harder than it might seem. But it's not off the table. It just didn't work that well when we tried it before. And we actually put a lot of staff time into that the first time around, because we were trying to get what we thought was an accurate census of programs. Anybody commenting?
Along with that same comment, we were talking about the similar type of an app that would allow a response, sort of like a wraparound Angie's List, where the comments are coming for the people to contact, but it's based on their real life events. So it's not somebody that just has a directory of Yellow Pages. That people don't want to see that. They want to see who successfully had a good reaction with that particular organization. So it would be more of an online app type situation. That would be real time. In other words, it wouldn't have to be updated, because it would be updated continually.
So kind of like Yelp for
correct. Yep.
So I'm wondering about providers in the room, like how would you feel about your organization getting Yelp, I guess? Yeah.
We had the same idea, talked about the same thing, about how you can be in a place that's kind of like a consultant, and there's nothing else that you can do, but you can be in a place that's kind of like a consultant, and you can't tell or use whether or not you were good or not, because the implementation, there wasn't a readiness to really implement our practice model.
Yeah.
It's not necessarily reflective of the work of that consultant. So it would be interesting, but I don't know. It would be hard to get a good, pure, unbiased perspective.
I agree. I think it's an interesting, I mean, I do feel that people are very motivated when they have a bad experience. I'm not so sure if they have a kind of reasonably good experience, whether they're very motivated to post anything. I don't know.
Which is that if it's trying to be face-to-face, it's better to have the ability to provide positive testimony on your consultant, but not really a scoring of good or bad, but the opportunity, because that builds references. And
right.
Will also give enough detail to what that person may be more expert around.
Mm-hmm. Well, someone else had a question? Yeah, go ahead. Oh, anybody have another follow-up to this particular topic?
Well, I think the whole idea with the app, and I think that Pat Lindsay was talking about, is that it plays into this without having that ability to really, you're not rating someone, but for instance, like she said, we have a family that we're working with and they're moving to Arizona. Does anyone know about, we're really coming up with wraparound services in Arizona? People are going to respond, and if they've got the fees coming through, kind of like the fees we've got coming through here. And we were just talking about how the youth are kind of blowing up the app here. Mm-hmm. They have really got their voice out there. And so I think that if we were getting real-time information that was coming through, it wasn't really about rating people, but more like connecting people, or, okay, just read this great article about adaptive change or whatever it happened to be, you can find it at such and such, then that would, it would be helpful to all of us. And I guess the only challenge would be, because I know we've always had this whenever we have Q&A, and social media is that, you know, you've got to make sure that, you know, someone gives a reference, like with those web link, but it's okay with that.
It's a moderation.
Keep it clean.
Have a moderator. Can that feed off of? Somebody has a solution. Wow.
But rather than trying to raise, it would make much more sense to list what's available. And those are kind of stable.
And then the distributor, the spreading, to the same network within.
Have them rate? The resource.
So that when you gave her a contact, so you say, I'm subject to what you're done, I'm going to look for that contact, whoever can, the person in that state. And that's who you would say, well, it's going to happen.
As a connector. Okay.
And you don't have to actually, but they will.
Okay, so let's quick go through any other low-hanging fruit ideas.
I would suggest that you develop a discussion board or a PowerPoint hosting area so that we can keep track of who's doing research, who's starting out, and when they're doing long reports published.
Right, and I think another thing you mentioned is that we can use things from prod. So I think once we get on our new website, we'll have these different, again, very much more accessible things that will probably sort of do a push out, and maybe our app would be a good way to do that. Now's the time to remember to post to on this topic or whatever, sort of topic of the week type thing. So, Yes?
I just wanted to say, you know, we didn't really talk about positive things that you already have. I love it when I open up the newsletter and it says, hi, Matt. I like that individualized approach. So it just makes me excited.
Good. Yeah. Well, I think what we're going to do is finish our short term. We're going to get our illustrious guest, Dr. Gary Blau, to provide some comments, and then we'll go back to the discussion, do the long-term ones, and then quickly move on into the rest of our discussion. So anybody else have some of those short-term, we could be doing better yet?
We talked a little bit about some of the materials can be a lot of information for people to process, although it's good content for those people that like to read and read and read. But maybe some more brief synopsis and or using more graphs and like quick, I can grab all the information or a good
amount. That's some good feedback. And I think, as I mentioned, that state-by-state report, I don't know if anybody's seen it, but it's just like page after page after page by state, that we're going to try to do some really high-impact kind of digest of topic by topic, sort of one-pager type thing. So hopefully we'll have a chance to do some of that stuff. Yes? Well, I have to admit that we have no active work groups at this exact time. I imagine that we will be having, I mean, that expert group that we're talking about will be sort of a new work group. It's sort of more around a project than an ongoing thing, but we'll be posting some updates about that project. Any other quick short-term fixy things, topics? Anybody want to do a webinar next year? All right. So we would like to invite Gary up to address us now. All right. Thanks for coming.
I want to give him a slide today. It's a big day. Hi, everybody.
Hello. Hi there.
How's the meeting going?
Great.
Awesome. So I was actually excited about the opportunity to come and say a few words, and I'll only take up a few minutes of your time today. At the same time, I think that there's so much going on, particularly, you know, NWI and things across the country, that really makes sense to you know, give a little bit of an update, maybe even let, you know, folks have any questions about things that are going on. First of all, one of the most exciting things that we're going to be talking a lot about over the next several days, and we've had an opportunity this week to bring attention to this with the Nashville Children's Directors. There's also been a push to have the substance abuse adolescent treatment coordinators here with us this week. It's really kind of exciting that, you know, we're doing a lot of work around this. And I wanted to comment on how many of you all are familiar with the SAMHSA CMS Informational Bulletin on Coverage for Behavioral Health Services for Teens and Young Adults. That's it. It's on the NWI website, and it's addressed to Matt. Well, I want to highlight this today for you, because if you're not aware of this document, you will be by the end of this week. And last May, as part of National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day, actually, SAMHSA, Pam Hyde, our SAMHSA administrator, and Cindy Mann, who is the director for the CMS, actually, Office of Medicaid and SCHIP Services, joined together to sign a groundbreaking informational bulletin on coverage for behavioral health services for young people. And I am bringing this up everywhere I go, because it will become this, it should be the new Bible, the new way that we do business, because it took 2.5 years to get CMS to agree to jointly sign this bulletin and issue it to all of the Medicaid directors across the country. And in this bulletin, it talks about essentially the coverage of services that Medicaid is willing to pay for through various means. Not all of them easy, I mean, granted that. However, they will pay for services, and they specifically talk about respite care. They specifically talk about family and youth peer support. This is huge. I mean, it took a lot of it. This took a lot, because the family support actually has a little bit of a database, a little bit of a empirical evidence base. Youth peer support was not quite, we're not quite there yet, and although despite that, there are some preliminary data indicating that when young people support each other, particularly those with lived experience, that their outcomes are better. And so they decided that they would go ahead and, in anticipating better data, that they would include that. I've spoken to the young people. Youth Move is already trying to look at creating national standards for youth peer support workers and things. This is huge. These are the very services that systems of care comprised of. And for you in this room, they included a fairly substantial section on what was called intensive care coordination, or wraparound. And for us, and for you all, and I think for the sustainability of services that really are at the heart of systems of care, this document really does have to be our Bible going forward. Unfortunately, I think we're not using it as robustly as I think that we could. And so that's why we are currently searching for those early adopters, states that really want to make a difference in doing this. I will tell you that our great state of Maryland, where we are right now, you're actually in Maryland. I know some of you thought you were coming to Washington, D.C. this week. You're wrong. It's over the river and through the woods and to the White House we will go, or something. But I think that the real issue here for us is that we can parlay this document into these kinds of actions. So I pick on Maryland because they are trying diligently to implement a 1915I waiver. You all are familiar with that. Marlene is familiar with that. Many of you are. And they're trying to use the information in the bulletin and the resources given and the financing ideas to come up with strategies to better finance and resource these services. For Wraparound and for the National Wraparound Initiative Open Meeting and 10th Anniversary Celebration, I think that it's really huge, because it really can allow the folks in the field doing the work to find and expand revenue streams, particularly through Medicaid. Our hope is that over the next 3 or 4 or 5 years, as this gets used more, that this will not only be identified for Medicaid, but oftentimes, most of you know, where Medicaid goes, sometimes at least, commercial insurers will follow. And so we're really hopeful. We need early adopters. And I picked on Maryland because as they seek to implement the 1915 I, sometimes what happens in Washington doesn't always trickle down to the regional offices of Medicaid. Imagine that. That Washington makes a directive that doesn't always get carried out in the states? I can't imagine. In this case, what it's being done is that what we're also trying to find out are, as states are trying to implement this and expand their services, particularly through the informational bulletin, what obstacles are there? How can we help to address them? How do we bring it to the attention of the central office at Medicaid, as an example, so that we can work with people to do overcome the obstacles and get these services in place and resourced? And one of the things that was really awesome was, and Marlene, you may be able to help me with this, because our technical assistance network, of which the NWI is a very substantial part of, does a rapid response to states and others that are involved in systems of care in order to help them address certain issues. And one of our great states was struggling with the payment. I think it was for parent support. Yeah. And the Medicaid agency actually was looking at rates and lo and behold, contacted the Technical Assistance Network. And within a day, TA Network turned around, provided guidance and information about rates related to this that increased the, if you'll excuse me a moment, increased the rates five times the amount that was originally proposed. I got that right, Marlene? Oh, in an hour, okay? In the vernacular of our young people that I was just at, serious props goes to that situation. Really, this is remarkable. So what's happened now in this particular state that will remain nameless because I forget. No, I'm pretty sure it was Arkansas, but that's okay. That now they're poised to be able to bill for that service at a rate that's more sustainable. And what I'm looking at here is that this is an opportunity for provider agencies, family organizations, and others to really parlay this. So we are excited about this. We're a little frustrated, in terms of the length of time it takes. But remember the data out of the National Institutes of Mental Health about how many years it takes for an evidence-based practice to get. Anybody remember this? Yeah, Nancy, you remember how many years it takes? Not exactly. Seven? Any other guesses? Seven? Match. You seem to be really popular here. Too long. It's right. Actually, the data were 17 years. 17 years before actual evidence-based practices that were identified gets to the more of an uptake. And that is, we lose an entire generation when we do that. So it has been my incredible pleasure and privilege to support NWI over the years. We used to do it cobble together and everything, and then all of a sudden we put out a new contract for a technical assistance, and we were able to convince the powers that be in SAMHSA that we would have an entire task specifically related to wraparound services. And lo and behold, the University of Maryland contracted out with our national wraparound team at University of Washington and Portland State University. And so they officially, without having to go through back channels or anything else, are part of SAMHSA's technical assistance network and part of the systems of care activity. So a big congratulations to them. Janet thanked me, but in all reality, I don't actually get to choose the contractor. So there's a whole independent group that does that. I'm happy about it. Don't get me wrong. I will take nor credit nor blame for any of those kinds of things that happen. The other thing that I'm really happy about, and I'm sure you've talked about, is after many years of really working in terms of the National Wraparound Initiative and what this means, is that NWI sort of is morphing. You're familiar with all of this. And I think that one of the things that's most exciting is to build a center of implementation support that can provide a more, I guess, hands-on type of support, more comprehensive support. And there now is, this whole concept of a new entity. The National Wraparound Implementation Center. And National Wraparound Implementation Center is this collaboration amongst three leading universities, of course, the University of Washington School of Medicine, Portland State University School of Social Work, and the University of Maryland School of Social Work. So the kinds of work that's actually being done out there, you know, in the real world is going to have this massive support because of, are you calling it NWIC? Or, you are. You're calling it NWIC. They're, you guys could be federal, you see, you know? They have an acronym. I guess that's a good thing. I am excited that NWI is going to continue to serve as a resource and a clearinghouse for materials that create a library of training modules, which is very exciting, and resources, and also more virtual training. You know, we're doing a lot more on the virtual training, mostly because of the GAO. You guys are not following me on this one. That's okay. Let's go back to Las Vegas, maybe. Apparently there was just a little meeting that got out of control. and so it's restricting our ability to hold the kind of meetings that we used to or support. As an example, the Georgetown Training Institutes. We made an agreement with them this past year that if they wanted to have a Georgetown Training Institutes, then they were going to have to find a way to sustain and fund it themselves. Because honestly, they, you know, having meetings of this size and this magnitude gets so much more scrutiny nowadays, and we wanted it to happen. We just can't support it the same way that we used to. And there's a wonderful example of how the federal government seeded great conferences, and then they took over and became fully and self-sustainable at the University of South Florida's Research and Center for Children's Mental Health. And so that particular conference, probably now over five, six years ago, was able to sustain itself without any federal funds. This is the first year that Georgetown is doing the institutes without the use of federal funds. Hence, it's not cheap. however, you get a lot out of a meeting like this. I think as we're going forward, virtual training opportunities is going to be really one of the areas that we're focused on. So as an example, how many of you all have been on a webinar lately? Awesome. Yeah. I like webinars. I give a lot of webinars, right? You know, I do webinars. How many of y'all multitask while you're on a webinar? Yeah, that's okay. That's okay. Uh-huh. Yeah, I have one better for you. I actually multitask while I'm giving a webinar. So when I'm speaking to you on a webinar next time, you're going to be wondering, is he doing his email while he's doing this? What I said is that it's really great that we have webinars. It's great. We need more training opportunities, and we also need to make them more engaging, more interesting. And training opportunities is what we're about, because oftentimes when you do something and you can share that with your colleagues, with your staff, in staff meetings. So we created something last year that we call Systems of Care Television. Anybody ever hear of this before? Oh, you have. Oh, great. So you are the ones that are watching. Tell your friends, please. KSOC-TV. For those of you on the West Coast, the K is props to the West Coast people, because all the people on the East Coast wanted it to be called WSOC-TV. Captain Andy Hunt from my staff, who's actually from Portland and stuff, said, you know, everything is so East Coast-centric around here. Shouldn't we do something for the West Coasters? And he said, why don't we just call it KSOC-TV? So we did. And anyway, so it's actually, we've done two episodes now, webisodes, I have to say. It's on the web. So we're calling them webisodes. When I'm typing it, when I'm doing my thing, saying, oh, watch the web, it still comes up as like a word that the computer does not understand. I bet it will understand this, however, not just ours, but others, down the road. And it's a new training tool. I am not Jerry Springer. I promise you that if you watch, you will not see me throw a chair. I am still a federal official, and so it's relatively conservative. And at the same time, what we're trying to do is morph this idea into a more engaging format. Well, while webinars will still exist, and they're great, that maybe every once in a while we can do it. So we're actually going to be hosting tomorrow as part of the opening plenary session. You get to hear from me a little bit more in the morning, as well as Father Boyle as the keynote speech. And then after have a live webisode broadcast from the Gaylord on youth and young adults in transition. And it's actually very fitting in terms of what, you know, some of the work that you all are doing. So there'll be some audience shots, of course, because it'll be kind of cool to show that there's 2,000 people going to be there. And so we're pushing the same way you all, virtual training, because, you know, in an hour, there's a lot of information. There'll be there's a news feature. Some of you have seen this. It's awesome. And so there's a news feature and video cut-ins and stuff that we're working on with our social marketing and communications team. So we're really pushing for more of this because we're not going to be doing the same level of gathering and flying people around the country, perhaps, as we used to. So those are little things. We're also, you know, there's lots and lots of things going on in the federal government right now. You may know we have a new secretary. Anybody know her name? Crickets. Nope, not crickets. Anybody remember the last secretary's name? Sebelius. Thank you, Mary. That's right, Secretary Sebelius. She was awesome, okay? She really was. She was a champion, and she was, you know, really did some really amazing work. Things like the class standards, if you're familiar with cultural competency stuff, and, of course, you know, the health reform initiatives and everything. Apparently, at the very end, there was some little glitch, apparently. But other than that, you know, there were a few other things that happened, and she decided that it was time to go home to Kansas. So the new secretary is actually Sylvia Burwell. Sylvia Burwell was formerly the director of the Office of Management and Budget, OMB. This is important because her background is much more in economics and you know, as much in healthcare than as compared to, you know, healthcare. And she has sort of three main priorities: metrics, metrics. Right? She's like the real estate guru of, you know, and she is a visionary leader. And she is coming into HHS at a time now where we are all going to be pushed to find new and improved ways to demonstrate that our work has positive outcomes, that it has an impact. I think this is even more critical for us in behavioral health because, honestly, we haven't done that as good a job in other healthcare fields. I mean, it's not as easy. You know when the CDC, you know, gives immunizations that people don't get diseases. That's pretty nice to count. You know, in behavioral health, I think it's a little bit more challenging. And so one of the things that we're going to be focused on a lot more is how do we demonstrate the impact of our programs. And it's great to talk about, you know, we had a meeting or we trained 283 people or, you know, whatever those numbers are. The real impact is going to be how did it improve lives? And I think that when you're applying for grants or you're addressing issues, and certainly in national wraparound and what you guys are trying to accomplish and we're trying to accomplish together, it makes a lot of sense to really focus on those metrics. And I know, for example, if accountability is what you are looking for, then the University of Washington's wraparound evaluation and research team, did I get that right? Yeah, wants you. You know, and so that would be a really awesome kind of a thing. Getting involved in that kind of accountability, the research approaches, and whether that means for the wraparound services or parent support providers or, you know, youth peer support workers, those are the kind of things. How is respite actually? I mean, it's great we provide respite. How do we demonstrate that it has improved the lives in various areas? So those are the things that we're going to be focusing on a lot of over the next couple of years, as there are apparently going to be, you know, new changes in Washington, as always is the case, that we're excited to see. You know, one never knows. So with all that being said, you know, I can go into lots and lots of details. Our Building Bridges initiative continues to be expanding, and we have Mary here and Jim and all this. Dan Embry is here, and, you know, folks that have actually, you know, been at the very forefront of building bridges between residential interventions and our community partners, and how we bridge that together, and how wraparound fits into that is so critical. because that's, I think, the way in which that we can move young people from longer stays in residential in back into the community and build those bridges. We'll be unveiling our new book on that tomorrow, Residential Intervention. This is a plug for the book, although I don't get royalties for it, so that's okay. And that's actually interesting. So Beth Caldwell, who's our National Building Bridges Initiative Director, and Bob Lieberman, who's a CEO of an agency out west, they're donating all of their royalties to youth engagement activities and youth empowerment. So I'm actually really proud of them for doing that. So buildingbridgesforyouth.org, if you haven't been on there, there's a brand new, and oh, P.S., I just tweeted about this last week, so if you're not following me on Twitter, shame on you. Otherwise, you would have known hot off the press just last week a new document from Building Bridges that actually addresses the needs of siblings of youngsters who are in residential treatment. And that document was done by our family and youth network, it is actually quite good. Concrete strategies for addressing and engaging the siblings in this process, because they often get lost. And that happens in a lot of our mental health services. We're so focused on the young person with the particular identified issue that we don't take into account the challenges that happen with siblings. And this was a wonderful way. And the family group particularly said this was a huge gap in our knowledge base and a huge gap in what providers do. Joanne knows this most, and so she understands. And so they created this document. Of course, it took 6 months to vet through all that, but it turned out great, didn't it? I think it did. So at Gary Blau, PhD, is my Twitter handle. I am trying to get more Twitter followers than my children. Thank you very much. I keep saying that because it's like my son said, it's not a competition. It's definitely a competition. Are you kidding? And I won't stop until I trounce him. So that's all good. We're also focused on some stuff like you may be aware that last year, a little controversy in SAMHSA. There's one or two representatives that are not overly happy with us these days and say we're not focusing enough on the serious mental illness side. For me, I do. So in terms of serious emotional disturbance and that language and at the same time, so they are, giving us a little bit of challenge. And at the same time, they're also doing some things that I think are pushing us in good directions. I still believe only about 28 or 29% of our budget at SAMHSA goes to any type of prevention or early intervention. It really is true. 70%+ of our budget goes to the most serious in need, as well as the most serious folks that have substance abuse issues. So I wish they would be more balanced in this. And you know what? You can criticize us all you want, but let's be more balanced. What they did do, however, is that in our block grant this past year, they added $40 million for us to address, it's called the 5% set-aside. If you're not familiar, you should be, that states now are given money. It depends on the state, because all that is formula-driven. So there's actually one of our territories, I think, got all of $23,000 out of it. But some of the states get more money to implement evidence-based practices related to early-onset mental illness, which of course includes early onset psychosis. And so we're doing a lot more work. In fact, September 19th, it's a Friday coming up, SAMHSA is housing a meeting. I didn't say hosting, you see. I'm learning all kinds of new ways to get around the conference meeting approval process. But the National Institutes of Mental Health and the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation have joined together to host a meeting of the national researchers that are involved with early onset psychosis kinds of things to come up with a strategy to look at a national network to disseminate evidence-based practices. So we're having that meeting at SAMHSA, and I'm excited about the kind of things that we're doing. You may be familiar with the President's Now is the Time initiative that came out after the terrible tragedy at Sandy Hook in Newtown, Connecticut. We put forth a number of proposals, and one of them really has stuck, and it's called Healthy Transitions. And we were given $20 million in 2014, and we've gone out with a request for application to states that would have at least two local pilot laboratories. We call them local laboratories, pilot communities. Maybe some of you in this room have applied for those grants. If you have, stay tuned. We're reviewing them, and hopefully we'll be awarding those. Of course, if you haven't heard anything by September 30th, that's bad. But we will be awarding those. We will be awarding those grants, and we're establishing the concept. These are 16 to 25 year olds. I think I've already proposed this in tongue-in-cheek way, but I think that I should morph. We are no longer the child, adolescent, and family branch. I want to be the child, adolescent, and young adult and family branch, because we are expanding. Yeah, awesome. And this is what we're doing. You know, we're expanding. I still have one of those young adults that he's off on his own, but, you know, he's still under my insurance because of Obamacare. So I am not complaining, and he can stay there. He'd be 25 in November, and so he has another year to find real work that has a real insurance fund. But in the meanwhile, so anyway, I can go on and on. We have so many of these things. The other part to it, my sister branch in our promotion and prevention world is implementing Project Aware. And Project Aware, anybody know what that stands for? Advancing Wellness and Resilience Education. I would like to say I was testing you, but I was actually trying to remember. that particular, it has two components to it. One is state-level education agencies, SEAs as they're called, to give them more, you know, money to create prevention and youth violence prevention programs in schools, sort of like morphing of our Safe Schools, Healthy Students program, as well as local education agencies to do the same kind of work. So we're really expanding in those areas. They need to give us more staff, I think, is that when all these things are happening. That's some of the highlights of what's happening. You know, at the same time, we're still struggling with all kinds of details out there, and of which NWI and now NWIC continues to be a great partner. And the work that you guys do and the promotion of wraparound approaches and, you know, the whole concept of what our colleagues at Medicaid refer to as intensive care coordination activities, and that's okay. You know, I have this philosophy that, you know, you can call it whatever you want as long as you're going to give money for it, and also you can take credit. You know, the new Healthy Transitions program. I don't know if any of you were involved in our former Healthy Transitions program. We kind of had to rename it. It's ending, but it was in its last 6 months, it was now called the Emerging Adults Initiative, which wasn't bad. I mean, you know, we made that up mostly because the new politicians wanted to take credit for the new thing, and so they didn't want anything else to be called the new thing, so we just changed the name of the old thing. As silly as it sounds, I don't care. You can call it Fred. You're going to give us $20 million to do something good for 16 to 25-year-olds. I'm happy about that. So, and you can take all the credit you want. That's really what the bottom line is. So with that being said, I want to thank you for giving me a few minutes of your time and attention. You know, hopefully all of you have tweeted about all this already. It's a vast difference talking about Twitter in this room than it was talking with Twitter at the Rockstar Youth Leadership Track. So I would say if in fact that you all have a young person that's with you, they can teach you how to use Twitter. It'll be good. Uh-huh. So in the meanwhile, again, thank you so much for your hard work and your efforts and for being here. Take advantage of all the things, the networking and the learning opportunities. I've been telling people, you know, I mean, what is it that you're going to bring home? What is that new thing, that one new thing that you can do, that you can bring home to make a difference that pays for your trip? Okay? So anyway, with that being said, thank you very, very much.
All right, well, and I do want to say that Gary has been one of our biggest supporters of our work as the NWI and of Wraparound generally, so we really are very pleased that he was able to drop by today and give us little updates. So kind of getting back to actually what he concluded on, what are we going to bring home, we're still in the second phase of our feedback. So this is the point where we're sort of dreaming in a somewhat realistic way about what the NWI might be doing in the medium term. If you can kind of tune your brains back to what we were doing right before the break, anybody want to take a crack at starting that discussion? Okay. Sure.
Best practices for staff transitions, keeping effective teams.
So,
oh, transferring teams from, to new staff?
Yeah, new staff, because they're leaving or separation or termination. Another one was, please don't throw anything at me, focus on skill sets. And I know it's been a kind of a discussion we've had over time, but some more guideline or best practices for skill sets and implementation. And then the last one was things, continuing ways to bring together the community. For example, like this or other ways to bring together, get the folks in the same room to sit together and shake each other's hand.
In person ways?
Potentially.
Potentially.
So that was it.
Okay, thanks. So anybody else in brainstorming of the longer term things or yes?
We had a couple. One was to have a family vetted piece that looks with your video work that looks at the family role before Wraparound starts. And making sure that there is a correlation that goes along with your video with that.
So looking at I think we were talking about the family partner engagement process and sort of what are the active ingredients of that and how well are they carried out. Can we see that in practice, right?
Grant's comment around that was so much of what the family partner does happening outside of that.
Sure.
And the Wraparound success is so dependent upon that. They really don't see it if you only see.
Right. And one point, actually, these guys brought up, however, I was sitting in on the discussion at the table, that we are trying to look, I mean, we're trying to get these videos from team meetings, too, but we're also hoping that the same sort of rubric for looking at what's going on would apply to the one-on-one kind of work, too, and to get some exemplars of that and do the same process through with that, and also with the family partner as well, because obviously the skills there are somewhat different, although very allied, obviously, too. Other thoughts? Yes?
Our first one long term, right?
Yep.
So we had a couple, and one was to kind of a put a definition about what Wraparound and standards that NWI would provide. Because I think we're looking at the idea of developing this is going to be a and what that helps to be able to do a standard definition, but then can be helpful to others as well. So we're able to work with NWI. And similarly along those lines, in that right now it seems that Wraparound is used in a number of fields, yet it's more understood in the mental health field, and really the systems of care, to have it understood in child welfare, and the most used field a lot, but also in behavioral health, and even in physical health, so that how this concept can really be across systems, and so sort of defining that as well, and that.
So that would be with partners in our existing kind of Wraparound approaches, or when Wraparound is completely taken out. I mean, for example, I know people using Wraparound, say, in transition from adult corrections to the community, for example.
People use it a lot. I just want to believe that in our state, people call us that normal. So it's used in schools. It's used in schools a lot. But I don't see it. I guess it looks like they're presenting that way, as much as I see as presenting as a national holiday. So if there's outcomes that can really show how it benefits the cross systems of the population, so that when you're working with a child and family that have a lot of outcomes in the experience, it can really show that one.
So that sort of gets into the research piece, too, as to what outcomes are you looking at, how can you inform people about the outcomes that they might be most interested in. I think our NRAP work may speak to some of that. And for, I mean, I think anybody who's looked at the Wraparound research, really the highest impact of Wraparound that we can prove at this point is in keeping kids out of expensive, out-of-home placements and in their communities, which is really a key outcome for a lot of different folks. I mean, everybody knows kids who move less are going to do better in school. I mean, it's just better for pretty much any outcome. So to the extent you can leverage that, there is information about that. And I do think our NRAP will, it's sort of if you've ever looked at those kind of menus that are exploding on NREM, it talks about the specific outcomes and the level of evidence for the different outcomes. So that's at least a start of a kind of a neutral place or an authoritative place to look for that information. So we'll keep you up to date on that when we hear the next thing. I guess we'll put it in the newsletter. I'm assuming the next step will be we start with that next piece of the process where they do the in-depth examination. Yeah?
I see the need for more research and things about the youth partner role.
Mm.
I think that right now in the field we're taking family partner role and kind of applying it, and I feel like in the training and technical systems, we don't really have a lot of research and information about the partner role to figure out what that all is. So long term, it would be nice to focus on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great idea. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? Yeah.
We were trying to brainstorm around the idea of sustainability for the NWI and diversity.
Oh, right.
obviously, in the university, there's development folks who can potentially work on plan giving, things like that. We were passionate people, even though we're not welcome people in this field, but I mean, things, you know, I'm not saying your staff because I know this is a full-time job, but getting those kind of engaging those folks, whether they're volunteers, to do things like, you know, when people get rid of their junker cars. And I mean, it sounds silly, but I mean, a lot of us do this for your community radio, your public radio stations, and things like that. So those kind of, you know, communal endeavors to keep you on that national audience. So we want to, you know, and I think that people would be willing. I'd be willing to give you, you know, the $20 a month I send to my radio station, you know, to send it to the NWI, because it's not very much for me. It's one of my lattes, you know, whatever pitches.
Uh-huh.
But I mean, I think those kinds of things, they do resonate with a lot of
us. Yeah. Well, our individual memberships, they currently do go through the PSU Foundation, so maybe not out of the question. I don't know how much effort they're willing to put out on our part to accept a junker or not, but maybe. Okay, great. Anybody else? Okay, well, there's a few things moving on. Our next topic is, and we'll have a chance for some more open discussion, and people are sort of trickling out, so we want to get to the rest of the planned stuff here, and then we'll have some more time for discussion at the end. So we wanted to talk a little bit about what NWIC is, and you should be seeing, I put a few of these, at least on every table, I don't know if anybody needs some more, down to circulate and get them out. And for me, who was getting lost in just prepared, is one of our partners at the University of Maryland Institute for Implementation and Innovation to get eyes and regulars. is here to sit lead on our discussion of NWIC, which is really newly developing, so we're just sort of getting started down these brochures we're putting as well. Would you go?
Yeah, and our
logo and all that stuff. So this is our vision for collaboration for the future and the now.
Yeah. So I do want to just start out saying, like Janet was saying, this is very new. We first started talking about this at the USF conference in March, but we've been working together as partners for many years now, really informally. That got a little bit more formalized when the University of Maryland got a contract from CMS to provide training and coaching and wraparound to PRCF waiver sites. And then when we started working with those states, we knew that there were things that we really needed to partner with Portland State and UW on in order to give states, you know, this full package of technical assistance. That is coming to an end, and as we talked about, you know, the waiver is coming to an end. We still have contracts in multiple states, and we have new on the horizon. So we wanted to sort of formalize our relationship. But again, super new, and you know, this is by no means the be-all and end-all. You know, when Gary talked about it as sort of this next evolution of NWI, I don't know that you see it that way. necessarily. I mean, there's things that are sustainable through this, but this is a package, and I'm going to talk a little bit about this, that is going to be something that some states and sites want to work with. There's always going to be a need for all the other folks out there who are also doing this work. You know, we're not coming into this as the be-all, end-all, and that we're going to work with every state and site in the country. But it's a package, and we sort of, I'll go through a little bit of this. We have a team of people who've been working together that is growing constantly. We have this leadership team, and we've been working to conceptualize NWIC and what we're going to do and how we're going to do it, and how we're going to contract with states, and that's been an ongoing process. And how is this going to be distinct from NWI, and what's the function of both of these sort of entities as we move forward, which we're still figuring out. We have a group of trainers and coaches, all of which are at the home table. Like, raise your hand. And we're hiring. If you know anyone who's interested, let me know. And then additional support team members who are phenomenally helpful in all of the work that we do. So what is NWIC? You know, we have really wanted to create this, you know, this package that I keep talking about that's grounded in implementation science, because in the work that we've been doing, and I'm sure many of you have experienced either being in a state or within an organization or consultants to other states and organizations, that if you don't follow a method that's really rooted in implementation science, your implementation is actually not going to be effective, and you're not going to get the same results that you would if you really did make sure that you had the key things in place to make sure that implementation of Wraparound was really successful. So in this integrated approach, we're focusing on three main areas of support, and that's the system-level support, workforce development, and evaluation and quality assurance. I'm going to go through each of those. So for systems level support, and again, we sort of talked about this a little bit, that anyone who's done any of this work knows that if you don't have the systems and the financing structures in place to implement, again, you're not going to have successful implementation. What we would see is going into states is that there would be a consultant that might be working with a state around financing models or system structures. And then there would be another consultant in the state, it might be us or someone else, who was talking about Wraparound implementation and doing training and coaching. And the more and more that states are talking about Wraparound as a customization for care coordination for these kids with complex behavioral needs attached to health homes, attached to care management entities, those two people need to be talking. You know, we needed to make sure that there was an integrated approach to the way we provided technical assistance. So as part of, again, this package, it kind of came with this pre-work and the work that kind of goes on throughout the entire training and coaching and implementation process. So sometimes we contract with Sheila Pyres and she'll go out and work with a state. Sometimes it's folks internally to the institute who will go out and work with a state, really depending on the needs and where they are, before we ever set foot into any kind of workforce development or implementation on that. Because again, we know until there's sort of this rock solid foundation, the other's not going to be effective when we're going to see poor results within Wraparound. And so we have had states reach out to us and say, hey, come and train and coach our masses. We're going to roll this out statewide. And once we start engaging the conversations, we're like, you know what, we need to hold on. We have some additional technical assistance we can provide you, or if you have another consultant, that's cool, but you need to lay this groundwork first. So that's one piece of the package that we thought was really important to make sure that in every contract that we do, it's sort of this full package. Workforce development, so this is where the training and coaching of Wraparound kind of comes into play, to where there's a set of core trainings, there's a coaching model, and tools that are used within that coaching model. We offer a train-the-trainer certification, so though we train the masses, we actually don't certify the masses, because we just don't feel like we have the capacity, or that that's something that really has the impact that we would want, because again, we see a lot of turnover in Wraparound, but there's key people who stay. Sometimes they're supervisors, sometimes they're the people who are the people who are already trainers within a state or people working at a state level. Whoever those folks are, we identify them and work very closely with them to build them up so that there's that local capacity within a couple of years, depending on the size of the rollout, but to be able to really sustain it after we've can sort of step out at that level of intensity. Working very closely with PSU with the virtual coaching platform, and again, that's part of the package, because what we found in contracts is that they're super high because of travel costs. You know, that we would have the same amount for the cost of personnel as we would for the travel to actually be there. And so I don't know that there's enough studies that have been done to say whether or not the coaching is going to be just as impactful. We think it is. We're going to give it a shot. But we're super excited to be able to start offering the VCP as part of that package to work with states virtually. And then the virtual wraparound coaching collaborative, that's something that as states sort of, or sites sort of move on, they don't need the same level of intensity, but they do want to manage drift. They're part of a coaching collaborative and still have access to the tools and support. And then evaluation and QA, again, I mean, we still continue to work in states and organizations that aren't evaluating their work at all. They're not using any of the WFAS tools, and we don't know if they're doing good work. We suspect in some places it's not as good as it could be, and in other places we think they're doing great work, but there's no assessment of that. So as part of our non-negotiables in putting together this package, this is a piece of it too, is to really provide that evaluation support. And that includes, I think Hattie's going to talk about this, you might have, probably should have gone first, so I'm not going to go too into depth of it, but you know, getting also to that place of outcomes for kids and families, so we know that you might have good fidelity scores, we might see that the impact of coaching and training is pretty good. What about 3 years out or 4 years out? How are those kids doing and what are we seeing in that kid level data and how does quality implementation really impact that? And then states would have access to Rapstar, which Hattie's going to talk about, so I'm not going to dig into, and then could also have access to Rap TMS Logic, or Rap Logic, sorry, I keep changing its name, TMS Rap Logic, which is an electronic behavioral health record. Are you going to talk about that too? Yeah. So that's a very quick run through. I don't know if you have anything that you want to add.
I just want to mention that, I mean, a part of our collaboration with NWIC is that each of these contracts that might come in is doing kind of its bit to support the NWI's mission. So our ability to keep doing the newsletters and the webinars and all that is being supported because these contracts are sort of through NWIC, realizing that that's something that the NWI provides globally. So it's kind of like their piece of the public radio contribution or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it's very flexible resource that we can put towards building the NWI's overall capacity to support the field. So we're very appreciative of this because a lot of things, you know, a lot of times I think a lot of people who work in this field, you know, you get a bunch of little contracts, but then you have to do stuff for those. So it's not flexible to allow you to do your mission how you see it. So that's something that we really feel is a huge benefit to us from working in this way. And of course it's a collaboration that we've had. Oh, okay, it's not me. Somebody's breaking in. And then just one other thing, too, is that a lot of these tools are not exclusively, so, I mean, you can get the Rapster or the whatever for your own work or your own state. You may not feel like you need comprehensive support, but you might need some of these tools. Certainly, these tools are available. So this is just a way of putting everything in a package that seems to be kind of soup to nuts, I guess. And part of the motivation is that people keep asking us for this. So this is a response to the field. So do folks have questions? Good job, John. It worked. Anybody have questions about this stuff? Okay, so as it's a work in progress, we're not quite sure exactly where it's going.
I would be happy to
hear your ideas.
Yeah, and again, like Janet said, there's pieces of this that are like a non-negotiable package. There's other pieces of it that aren't, and we're also still figuring that stuff out. So it's very new, but it's pretty exciting, and we look forward to even for those of you who are doing training and consulting, you know, to be able to partner as we think through all of this.
All righty. Okay. So Hattie is going to fill in all the pieces on what Wirt has been up to, and I'm assuming you can switch your own slides.
Just press the down button.
Don't tap the microphone.
Right. Good idea. And I think I might just like do, I don't even know. Okay, yeah, that works. I'm too short to stand behind that, so that's not going to work for me. All right. So
I'll just give you our org chart here while I kind of introduce myself. My name is Hattie Quick. I'm actually here on behalf of April Sather, my supervisor, who had a family emergency, so I'm kind of filling in. So to just be fair, I don't know these slides like the back of my hand, as it's her presentation. However, I'm going to do my best to get through this information. And you can just see this is just a quick layout about who we are and who's on our team. And a lot of people have probably spoken with some of these folks, so they should be familiar faces and names. And then if anybody does have questions that I can't answer for whatever reason, we do have our email address here and our website as well for additional information after this. Okay, so as Marlene mentioned, I'm going to talk a little bit about WRAPSTAR, Wraparound Structured Assessment and Review. And actually on this back slide here, Jennifer Schuer-Coldiron, who's just on the far left at the top there in blue, is really going to be the main person to contact if you do have additional questions about this. And we also have, I brought these pieces of paper up as well, on our table in the hall, we have like a little info sheet on WRAPSTAR, as well as WFAS, the Wraparound Fidelity Assessment System. So you can guys can feel free to pick up this information or contact info is on there as well. So in terms of what WRAPSTAR is, the obviously you can see an external evaluation protocol. There are a couple of components, fidelity and outcomes. That'll be fun. Okay. So fidelity and outcomes, which is connected to our WFAS tools, the WIFI-EZ, the TOM, team observation measure, document review measure. And with that component, we're actually looking at these type of questions, like how well does the community or organization, their WRAP practice adhere to the WRAP principles? Also, what impact is WRAP having on youth and families' lives? As well as how sustainable is the Wraparound initiative for that community. So those are the kinds of things we're looking at for that component. The second component, implementation and system support. And this is obviously, as you can see, collected by interviews, staff surveys, the community supports for Wraparound initiative for the CSWI. And for that piece, we're asking questions like how has Wraparound been implemented by the organization? Is there enough staff development, leadership, and organizational support to sustain high-quality Wraparound? And what are areas of strength and need? As well as, finally, how well developed are the necessary state and community levels of support for Wraparound? So those are kind of the main questions that we're asking through that. It's about a four-month process. And we're currently piloting this in Washington State, so more to come soon. But I do want to read a few other pieces of information about it. So it's a structured way of combining the WFAS tools into comprehensive fidelity and outcome scores based on key practice elements of the National Wraparound Initiative model. Over the course of those 4 months or so, those communities will provide information about those operations. They'll do some remote observations that will be videotaped. And additionally, they'll be providing feedback from staff, youth and families, other stakeholders using those fidelity measures or tools. They will then receive information about how faithfully they're adhering to that Wraparound model. And additionally, their implementation in areas such as that staff selection and training, leadership support, and administration. And then what will they do with this information, essentially, is the next question a lot of people have, how this information can be used. So in a final report, it can be used to celebrate successes and spur in-depth conversations, that kind of thing. So more to come about this, but that's just a little blurb. Okay. So we're just going to continue on since we don't have too much time left. So additionally, you may recall the Wraparound Fidelity Index 4. We've kind of condensed it down, and we've got what we now call the WIFI-EZ, the short form. This is a self-administered tool, and you're going to hear a lot more about this in our Institute 4, which again is tomorrow and Saturday. So more to come about that as well. But we have started to put together some national means of about 1,000 WIFI-EZs that we've collected just in this past year. It kind of just came out in 2013, and 15 sites have provided that data to us. Excuse me, you'll see a slide here in a second showing our national means. And additionally, they're based on key element scores as well. And we're also trying to determine a better kind of way to interpret these easy scores. And we're doing that through WrapTrack, which is a kind of a component of this TMS WrapLogic. So I'll talk about those details in a second as well. It's going to be really impossible to see that slide, but here's just a really quick visual of sort of what it looks like. I'm just going to skip ahead, but there are a couple of different sections here. You know, obviously, the areas of the WIFI Easy that we collect are exterior experience and wraparound, outcomes, and satisfaction. So those are sort of these sections of the WIFI Easy. You can see here section B. And if you can't read that, the like an example question is, my family and I had a major role in choosing the people on a wraparound team. And so you can kind of just go through and select on that Likert scale. And then I think there might be, yeah, there's our national means. And you can kind of see the differences between the WIFI-EZ, WIFI-4. We just have a ton more data on the WIFI-4, obviously, because that's been around so much longer. So, for example, we have, for the facilitator data, we have 52 sites collected, about 5,400 forms for that, just one example. So that's what we're looking at. Excuse me. Let's talk about the TOM 2. And we also have modified our team observation measure, and it's been condensed and shortened as well. We have gone back and forth with the help of University of Maryland, Portland State, our internal staff to kind of really update this measure. We've clarified the language. As you can see, we've reduced it from 71 to 40 indicators. And we also have aligned it with similar key elements from the WIFI Easy. And we're currently pilot testing this as well. And we're doing that in Washington State, which is exciting. And we're going to kind of move away from just internal testing in the fall. So more to come as well on that one. But here are just those elements or domains of the TOM 2 that we're looking at. And it's not on the slide here, but here are some example questions as well. For an identified need, the team discussed potential barriers and generated multiple strategies to meet that need. If progress was not evident, the plan was reviewed or barriers were addressed. So those are just some example from that as well. And then here's that little slide about what we're doing in terms of piloting the TOM 2 and how we're going to be expanding that come the fall. So you'll see some of that stuff on our wrapinfo.org site also. Okay, so moving on to WrapLogic, my slide here. So TMS, probably a lot of people have heard about that. And TMS WrapLogic is what it's called now. And it's a social technology work. And it's on that team monitoring software, which is also where, and some of you guys might be familiar with the WrapTrack, which I've mentioned briefly here, but WrapTrack is housed on that platform. So we'll talk a little bit more in depth about that, but the TMS software is the larger way of kind of tracking and monitoring things using that electronic health record that's related to all aspects of the wraparound team, whereas WrapTrack is really just that fidelity component. So those are those differences between the two. So with this work, we've been funded to kind of do some of this, elaborate on this electronic health record. As you can see, a few other items that we've been tasked to work on, as well as, you know, continually support a progress monitoring, as well as behavior software to, that's a weird sentence to say, behavioral health needs and practice model fidelity of implementation. That sounded weird. That's not right. Okay, but you can kind of get the drift. And then additionally using that data to continue to make to continue decision making. So that's a slide and a half. Okay, keep moving on. And then additionally, here's some components of TMS Wrap Logic that you can see. There's Workflow Builder, Assessment Builder, Report Builder as well, which is coming out new. And Kelly Hyde, who is our social technology representative, can really speak more to this. Again, that's going to be in our Institute 4, so come to that. But the system is HIPAA, high-tech, FERPA compliant, cloud-based. It's flexible, customizable, data-driven, secure. So again, there's going to be more about those features coming up. There's that slide telling you exactly all about it. All right. And then finally, we're just going to briefly talk about what we've been doing with Wrap Plus Map, which is managing and adapting practice system. And we've been kind of working on this in Washington State again recently. We've got two studies underway in five counties throughout the state. And we currently have 15 clinicians and facilitators trained, and we're going to continue to do that work throughout the fall. We're currently conducting focus groups and interviews, and additionally, implementation and outcomes are going to continue on into the fall as well. So it's exciting work. And then just a little bit about sort of their PWEBS, what they call PracticeWise EBS database, and it's where they house all of that information. Again, you can see here approximately 700 trials that they've kind of captured and synthesized and put into this PWEBS database. And then they also have process guides and practice guides that they allow the clinicians and facilitators to use in order to successfully continue their work. And that's actually our last slide, but one last thing I do want to just mention briefly is our Wraparound Community Learning Collaborative. And this is brought up as is actually part of our presentation at Tampa in March, and we are moving forward with that. So for those of you who might have attended that particular session, we do have a website up where we're doing some blogging and asking folks to kind of become what we're calling quote-unquote members of that. There's no fee, just a process of signing up and sharing information between communities. So if you want to know more about that, again, I have a sign-up sheet on our table that's, you know, in the hallway of tables. So please come and see that as well to sign up and to do know more information about it. So I think that's all I have to say today. Gosh, that is a lot of stuff, but mouthful. All right, thank you, guys.
Okay, well, I think we can all agree Hattie did a great job. Because it was April filling in for Eric, and I think Eric conceptualized what was originally like 70 slides for 15 minutes. If you're familiar with Eric, you know that's, he could probably do that. So anyway, very good. And if you want to know more, the Institute will have, I think, cover almost all of this in a much more reasonable amount of time. I think a lot of that went by really, really fast. So we did, I mean, we're kind of at the end of our formal program now. I think we just wanted to have a chance to let you guys talk or to, I think we'll just take any questions or discussion or any kind of anything that we've talked about today. And I did want to encourage you to eat cake. It looks like there's a lot there. And you know, this is a hotel. We paid a lot of money for that cake, so eat it. Or don't, it's fine. And what else? Oh, and also we have these classic NWI coasters. I think I put a few out on the table. If anybody wants, and they'll be on our table too. But these are actually excellent coasters. So if anybody didn't get any, we have more.
There is an NWIC edition. It will be coming.
Oh yeah, right. We'll have NWIC coasters also. So I think really, does anybody anything to say, including next time we do this meeting, should it be different, or anything you feel like letting us know about at this point, feel free. Or come up and talk with us at the end. Please, before you go, if you have an interest in being part of that video study, if you, what else did we talk about? Oh, any other ideas, if you want to drop off your table's listing of thoughts, that would be really helpful. Yeah, any other check-ins? I can't remember.
That's about it.
Yeah. So, comments? Everybody ready to hit the pool? All right. Well, thanks, everyone, and feel free to let us know about any of your thoughts by media. Okay. Great. Okay.
Hi. Hi, Shannon. Sorry. There we go. You said make sure the radio was good.